behalf of the officers of the church, I'd like to welcome you to First Presbyterian Church. And personally, I'd like to say Happy New Year to everyone. Hope you've eat your hog jaw and your black eyed peas and you're at church. So we're three out of three. We're doing good. We have a few announcements that I'm going to call your attention to. Next Sunday, the ordination and installation of the new officers will be Sunday, January 10th. Christian Education has a meeting this coming Wednesday night at 6. And then a new women's Bible study is going to begin Tuesday night at the home of Jenny Tyner.
Morning.
Oh, Tuesday morning. Don't show up at 9 o'clock at night. She's going to be upset with me if y'all do that. And there are new offering envelopes outside, so pick those up on your way out. If you will, please stand for the call of worship. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to a king's son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice.
And may the mountains yield prosperity for the people, and the hills in righteousness. May he defend the cause of the poor, give deliverance to the needy, and crush the oppressor.
May he live while the sun endures, and as long as the moon throughout all generations. May he be like rain that falls on mown grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may righteousness flourish and peace abound until the moon is no more. Now let us come together in worship before the table he has prepared for us. Amen and amen. If you will, please remain standing for Angels from the Realms of Glory, verses 1 and 5. If you will, recite with me what we believe is in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Our first scripture reading today will be from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring light to everyone is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God, who created all things, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be known to the rulers and authorities in heavenly places. This was according to the eternal promise that he realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now as we continue in worship, let us come before the Lord our God with our confessions, first silently and then together in unison. Let us pray. Amen. Now let us pray together. Almighty God, only you are holy. Only you are good. We stand before you convicted of our sins and broken under the weight of the law. Our pride of self and stubbornness seek to drive us from your presence. Do not hold us guilty or remember the sins of our youth, but save us by the righteous blood of the Lamb. We pray in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Friends, it is true we have all fallen short of God's glory, each one of us in our own right, by what we have done or left undone. In thought, word, and deed, we have counted ourselves out of the Lord's kingdom. But God would not leave us in that state. God would not leave us excommunicated from him. But he reached out and did what we could not do. By sending Christ into the world, by giving us that precious gift, we learned the true nature of God's love for us. And as he grew in power and wisdom, as he showed forth the message and the teachings of our Lord, we grew closer and yet still separated. It wasn't until he reached his ultimate act and taking on our sins, dying on the cross on our behalf, and being raised on the third day, showing us the true and manifold love of our God, who takes away our sin, who reunites us and promises eternal life with him in his kingdom forever and ever. Friends, hear and believe the good news this day. Through Christ Jesus, we are forgiven. Amen, amen. And amen. And now I'm going to invite the children to come forward for our time with youth. Yeah, if I get down on the floor, I'm never getting back up. Well, Happy New Year to you all. Did you guys have a good Christmas? Did you get lots of good stuff? I always love asking that question because the parents are like, the answer is yes. Well, you know, it's wonderful to get gifts. And a matter of fact, today in my sermon, I'm going to talk about the sort of the last portion of the Christmas story. Does anybody know what that entails, what we're going to talk about? Jesus' birthday, right. And he got three gifts from three special people. The three wise men. That's right. And they brought him, do you remember what they brought him? Gold and frankincense and myrrh. Now, that was to fulfill a prophecy saying that the nations would bring their wealth to Israel and that they would present the chosen one with these gifts. And so they brought him gold, frankincense, myrrh. And now, I can tell you right now, when I first heard this as a kid, I mean, I got the gold, because you can get toys with gold, so that one was cool. The frankincense and myrrh, actually, I thought they said Frankenstein, and I don't know why they would do that. But, but
is frankincense, which is actually an ointment, and then myrrh is something they use in the burial process. So each one had a special thing. The gold was to represent that he was a king. The frankincense was to represent that he would be the high priest. And then the myrrh was to basically anoint him for his sacrifice that we talk about him dying on the cross for us. And so in that moment, these three wise men, and they were called magi, but I like the idea of calling them wise men because what they gave really showed what God was going to do with Christ's life. But ultimately in that, they got the better gift. And what did they get?
Jesus.
That's right. They got what we got. They got Jesus. And so now we're starting a new year. And I just want you to enjoy all your toys and all that. But remember, the greatest gift every year that we get is the one that God gave us, and that's Jesus. And he gives that to us so he can be in our heart and be with us no matter how scary the world looks, no matter how weird things get, no matter how dark the night is. Then we still have Jesus with us because he will be with us. It says that whether we are living or dead, we belong to Jesus. And you know what? And for those of us that believe in Jesus, we never really die. We may leave this earth, but then we go to him. And so that's a wonderful promise and assurance. Amen? So let's say our love, help me care, help me smile, help me share, help me give, help me grow, help me laugh, help me know. Amen. Well, thank you so much. If y'all want to head off to Children's Church.
Earlier this morning, our Sunday school classes, we compiled a list for the people that are in need of prayer. And after I'm completed reading the list, you can add to it if you have anybody. Tracy Lowe, Terry Tucker Baxter, Heron Yarbrough, Jimmy Harper, Demetra Hickerson, Cindy George Cheatham, the family of Sylvia Hankins, the family of Donald Davis, Dawn Smith, Carrie Temple, the Alice Rose family, Mark Crocker, COVID victims and families, Terry Brown, Robert Mackin, Mandy Elliott, Mike Wallsmith, Nina and Billy Cash, Madison Hardy, Jack and Brenda Reagan, Butch Cottom, teachers and students, the Shan Martin family, Corbin, Shanna, Rogan, traveling back home to Washington, Betty Jo Walker, Linda Phillips, David Temple, Harold Swindle, Cartha Williams, Glenda Martin, and we have 7 unspokens today. Are there any others?
Cliff Sheridan.
Katie Dean.
The family of Calvin Rutherford.
Are there any others? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we humbly come to you today, you know, recognizing that we need you. Father, we know that through our free will we do things on this earth, but we also know that everything is in your hands, everything is in your timing, and everything that you allow to happen is you already know about it. You already know what's going on, Father. We just ask that if it's in your will, you be with the people that are sick. Put your healing hand on them. Father, we ask that you comfort and be with those that are grieving. We ask that you be with the unspokens that, you know, have things going on they're not ready to publicly talk about, Father. If it's in your will, Father, we ask that you give them peace and understanding and you be with them. Father, we just ask that you be with us as a church body, as your church body. We continue to try to be your face in all the things that's going on in our world, Father, and to show your love and your kindness and just to be you here on earth. Father, we ask all these things. We ask you to lead us in your Son's prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us of our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, if you will, you can bring your offering up to the front. Father, we thank you for all the many blessings you've given upon us. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today to praise and worship you in your house. Father, just we ask that you take these tithes and the offerings and bless them and guide the leaders of the church that they may use them to further your kingdom and that it's in your will to help grow your church, Father. Just in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today our scripture lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew. We'll be reading from the second chapter, the first 12 verses. Again, that is Matthew 2, verses 1 through 12. Let us hear now the Gospel. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all of Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. And they told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring word to me so that I also may go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, and they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. I'm going to warn you, I asked the kids the easier questions, so you all get the harder ones. And I expect the same level of reply, and when I say something funny, I want at least one or two laughs. I'm kidding about that. Well, today is our celebration of Epiphany. It's kind of an interesting, in the church year, if we were worshiping all the time, Epiphany normally would be held on the 6th, which this year falls on Wednesday, which is kind of in the middle of the week, so it's sort of preacher's option. I can either do Epiphany Sunday this Sunday or next Sunday, and since we're doing the altar installation and some other things, I thought maybe we would go ahead and do it this Sunday. So in doing Epiphany, first of all, the word itself, what's it mean?
A revelation.
A thought. You can almost envision, if you watch the cartoons or something, it's when that little light bulb appears above the head and goes, bing! Now, for some people, it's brighter than others, but, you know, it's that idea of a thought or a revelation that is given to you. It's not something that you discover on your own. It's something that comes to you. And so, when we talk about the advent or the coming of the wise men, it is the epiphany that and started their journey, and then, of course, they come and they get to see the Lord. So for us, Epiphany has to do with not just an idea that came to us individually, but an idea or a revelation that was for the whole world. And of course, that revelation is Jesus Christ. All right, we're on track. You guys are keeping up with the kids. This is like the biggest, weirdest game of Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader? That's probably been... I probably have to pay royalties or something to Jeff Foxworthy for that one. So we ourselves, during the Epiphany, this is also the time when we sort of close out the Christmas season. This is the sort of the official end. So if you haven't already, you can now take down your Christmas decorations. Matter of fact, next Sunday we'll have all this put away until next year. But again, as I said last Sunday, just because we're putting the decorations away doesn't mean that we're closing out Christmas, because Christmas should live in our hearts continuously. But in the seasons of the church, in the flow, this is one where we turn and we start hearing stories and move on into the baptism of the Lord, some of Jesus' preaching, which will lead us into Lent and Holy Week, Easter, and so it's this cycle that just continues to go on. I thoroughly, I love going through it year after year, because I think it sort of deepens our faith. It awakens us. It gives us room for even more epiphanies. Have you ever gone to a verse in the Bible that you've read 50 or 60 times, and then suddenly it says you see something there that wasn't there before? You actually have to go back and reread it again just to make sure that you weren't inputting that. Have you ever had that happen? Well, as a preacher, that's one of those great things. But sometimes it's embarrassing, because if you preached a sermon that took it this way, and suddenly you have epiphany, and you go, wait a minute, it's really over here. Now I have to say this. And especially now that we're recording these things, people go back in their recordings and go, but you know, 15 sermons ago, you said this. And my answer to that is, if you are one that would do something like that, my answer is going to be the same. I'm human. I never claimed to be the smartest man in the room. The only thing I've ever claimed is that God called me to do this and has put me up here, and I do my level best. So I will mispronounce things from time to time. If you catch me in it, I'll just smile and go, that's the southern pronunciation. Not the southern is in the south here, but the southern Israel, the southern kingdom. Of course, people go, really? And I went, no, I don't know. So let's go through the story, because this is a story we all know. So we have three magi. Well, actually, the truth is, we always say it's three, but the Bible never says that it's three. There's three gifts, so I think it's a safe assumption. The only time I ever move away from the three is if we're doing a children's pageant and we only have two kids that want to be kings. That year we have two kings. And if we have five, well, then we have five kings. Because, quite frankly, I believe when it comes for a children's pageant, we should let them, you know. Why would you make a kid be a donkey if he wanted to be a king? I mean, that's just not a good message at church. So, we have the Magi,
of whom we assume there were three. And the term magi means wise man or astronomer, astrologist. It's kind of a combination. We would call it astrology because they're looking for signs in the heavens. So, you know, but astrology is not something we really caught into these days. But they were also astronomers because they studied the sky and they had great knowledge. These individuals were rightly called wise men because they had studied. They were very learned. They were also very well off because not everybody in those days could just pack up in one country and travel to another on a whim. And so we have the wise men who see this thing in the heavens that is going to happen, something that hasn't happened for thousands of years. And I've seen stories that talk about it. They can kind of almost see that there are going to be some planets and a star in alignment that is going to cause a very interesting visual effect in the sky. Now, I don't know if you guys remember this. I guess it was, what, 3 or 4 years ago when we had the planetary alignments? Did anybody go out and did you get to see that? I mean, now I do remember that there were some people that warned, you know, that this only happens every so often. When it does, there were going to be strange things that happen. Well, I guess the effects were delayed until this last year. But that's kind of what people sometimes do. They look at these signs and go, oh, all the planets are in line. That must mean something. Well, it means that they just all happen to line up. I mean, sometimes I don't think there's always something there. A bird flies overhead. People, oh, that's good luck. Well, it is unless he deposits something that... We've all been to the beach. That's happened to most of us. I don't really consider that lucky. But these wise men, and in these days, they were the closest things we had to scientists because they used a lot of scientific method, but they also used these to sort of discover and to look at what might be coming. And so they saw what was going on, and to them they said, okay, let's look through all the literature, let's look through all the things that we have and try to figure out what exactly this could mean. Come on and have a seat. So when we asked, what does this mean? They said, there must be something powerful, a king being born, somebody great coming. And when they started looking through the literature of the days, now this is the interesting part, because these folks were not Jewish. They were not related to the Jewish people. And yet, they looked to the Jewish people's history and some of the literature that they had in order to try to figure out what this was. Now, that doesn't really seem all that incredible, except it would be like us, and I'm gonna risk this one. I know it's one of those crazy things. It would be like us looking for greatness in sportsmanship from the University of Florida. See, I had to run through a couple of universities in my head to figure out what would get me the least trouble. Okay, I found a little bit of trouble. Okay, the University of Florida in the Steve Spurrier days. Can I get away with that? Okay, I'm digging a hole. I'm just going to move on. But it's really kind of weird because they were in a higher cultural area. They didn't really look at the Israelites. Nobody looked at the Israelites as a great people. They weren't great warriors. Occasionally they had some wins, but they really didn't control much. Matter of fact, the Babylonians, the Assyrians, the Egyptians, all had taken their turn in taking over Israel. And so there wasn't a lot about great wisdom, great literature, great armies that came out of Israel. And yet, when these wise men started looking at it, it all lined up with a prophecy that came from the Hebrew tradition, out of the Hebrew scrolls. And it was about a Messiah, a king that would be born, a leader that would rule over his people. And so they decided to set out. And again, that's a pretty impressive thing to do. That would almost be like our senators going down to Guatemala to see Guatemala City's mayor installed. I mean, it's a small, minor country with not much to speak of as far as power in the region. And yet, because they had seen this, because they had an epiphany, because they had this idea that there was something to this, something more than most folks could see. And so they got there and they journeyed. And it was a long journey. Now, another myth that we can dispel A lot of us, if we put up manger or creche scenes, how many of you put your wise men up as soon as you put the manger scene up? It's okay. I do it too. And some of them, you know. It looks better that way. It looks like a full set. You know, otherwise you just got a barn sitting on your cabinet. You're like, well, what's that? But in truth, if we listen to the story, it said that they came to the house and found the child. Not they came to the manger and found the infant. And so they arrived, and later on in the story we find out that it's about 2 years. And they arrived at a house where Mary and Joseph were. Now, they present their gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now, I told the kids this, but I'll go ahead and reiterate. Now, the gold was why? Because Jesus was the king. He was the new king, the promised king. But they brought him frankincense, which was because he was also the priest of priests. He was the new high priest. And then they brought him myrrh, which is for burials. Again, indicating, foreshadowing what he was destined for. Now, how do these three wise but not Jewish men know this? How do they come by this information that this king would also be a priest, would also be a sacrifice? Except that it was the grace of God. Interesting side point here. These wise men, again, not Jewish. But we have no connection to Judaism whatsoever, and yet God had revealed himself to them and through them. Now, the only part in this whole story that I kind of go, I don't think that was that wise. They went to Herod. Now, think about that. That'd be like me walking into Mayor Rickey's office and go, hey, where's the new mayor? He's like, what? I didn't even know we had an election. Which, of course, I don't know. Did they do the election recently for mayor here? I don't know. And so Herod and all of Jerusalem gets upset, which is interesting because these are the Jews. These are the ones who should have been studying those scrolls, who should have been in the know, who should have been seeking the coming of a Messiah, been seeking the signs, been folks who would have been aware of what was going on. And when these three wise men show up asking about these signs, asking about where the king was, asking about where the fulfillment of this prophecy was, at first they were dumbfounded, they were worried, they were upset. And so Herod sends the scribes back to their scrolls and they go through them. They go, oh wait, we've got the answer. It's the child is supposed to be born in Bethlehem. And so then the king, instead of being glad that a prophecy in the Bible is fulfilled, he does what so many people who are trapped in worldly power, so many people who don't truly divest themselves of what they think is good for them and submit themselves to what God says is good for us. And he comes up with a plan and sends the wise men on, go and find them, then tell me and I will come and pay homage too. Now, we know the rest of the story. The wise men are warned in a dream and they go home by a different route, thus thwarting Herod. Also, if you read on in the story, Joseph and Mary are visited by an angel in a dream who said, what?
Flee.
Yeah, flee, get out of here, take your child, go to Egypt. Which again fulfilled another prophecy, out of Egypt I will call my son. So again, we see in this, the prophecies continue to unfold. But Herod, not dissuaded by this, and showing his malice and his cruelty, then kills every child in the region. 2 years and younger, which sadly also fulfills another prophecy. There was a weeping in Ramah. Rachel would not be soothed, for her children were no longer. And so, as I read through this, that's the one prophecy. I mean, most of the prophecies we hear, we go, yes, that was fulfilled. This is one that you go, ugh, that was fulfilled. And it actually kind of took me in a different direction with this. When I was first putting this together, I wanted to talk about, you know, all the neat things about Epiphany and just sort of point out the story. But as it drove me to this place, to this one prophecy, I remember all the times in my ministry when I've sat with a family who has suffered tragedy, when I've been in times when there was great darkness, when I've been to regions that are ravaged by war and I've seen the effects on their people and our people and been asked the question, why? Why would this be? And there were some who weren't fairly religious who would ask me, well, you say God is a loving God. If God is a loving God, why would a loving God allow these people to suffer? And I'm sure that question, maybe not in those words, but I'm sure there have been times in the last year when we have said, why would God allow this to go on as it has? If not that, then at the very least in this story, why would God allow the children of Bethlehem during what was the greatest season of joy, the birth of Christ, to then be taken? And it's a hard question. And it seems so wrong. But we have to remember a couple things. First of all, God did not do that. God did not ordain that. What God allowed was for the will of man, both for good and for evil, to play out. And I would ask you this, and this is a hard question. While there are many people we would say, I wish God would take that person and blight them off of history, would remove that person from all accounts. I wish that that thing had never happened. But where does that stop? Would you wish that God would take control of your lives and take away your free will? Would you wish that God would deny you the moment that you accepted Christ and what he had given to you? That he just turned you into a puppet? No. God gave us this gift of free will. And unfortunately, in our sin nature, and all of us have it, and that's the thing we have to... Now, none of us would go that far. None of us are that evil. But we all have this little bit of inkling in us that makes us from time to time do things that we shouldn't ought to do. Definitely do things that we wouldn't want everybody to know that we have done. But God also allows us the free will to confess those things, to repent of those things, to come back to him. And so, I find solace in this. Those children, those who have gone beyond, like I was asked today, about people dying, is Jesus with us? And that is the whole point of the gift, is it not? That we will have life and have it eternally. Maybe not in the way that we thought originally. Maybe not have the years that we thought here. But we are guaranteed that we have a place in our Father's kingdom. We are guaranteed by the Christmas story. We are guaranteed even by the story of the children being slaughtered in Bethlehem. That God is ever present. And while we may not understand what he allows or what happens in the story, we can be assured that no matter what happens, no matter how horrible, no matter how insane, God is still in charge. God is still loving and caring and compassionate. God has still given us the gift that we can't even fully understand. The salvation from knowing Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior. You know, going back to the wise men part of this, I told you that the wise men were seeking. Now, there's a difference between seeking and sightseeing. When you're seeking, as they were, you're going there for a specific intent. You are looking to find some bit of meaning. And you're open to what you find. Sightseeing is you're going there to just see what's up, and then you leave just pretty much the same as you were. The wise men did not. When they came, they fully didn't understand because they were not raised in the Jewish scriptures. They were not raised in synagogues and temples. They did not get the benefit of knowing all of this. And yet, when they were confronted, when they met the child Christ, they knelt down and worshiped, and they were transformed. They were changed, and they continue to be God-fearers, God-believers from that time on as they go back to their country. They were seekers. The Israelites and their king, who should have been seekers, who should have been that, they were sightseers, or they were bystanders. And that happens sometimes when you've been in church or you've been in faith for a long period of time. things get kind of rote. For some of us, we've seen 50 or more Christmases. And it's easy to sometimes get the been there, done that. Yes, we know the right responses, but can we get through this? Because this season really kind of cuts into my time, or it does this. I mean, I've seen it. It happens to people forever. And maybe it's not Christmas. Maybe it's other holidays. Or maybe it's just, hey, you know what? I'm really busy at work. Things are going crazy. I don't know what to do. And church becomes second, third, fourth. Or I go to church every Sunday, but halfway through the sermon, I check out. Now, that may be on me. And if that is the case, I apologize. But it may be on you because you're trying to think what you're going to have for Sunday lunch or trying to figure out what you need to do first thing Monday morning. In which case, I say there's plenty of time later to do that. Now we should be listening to the Word. There's times we go to Scripture and we read the Scripture and we see the words and we get what they mean. We can put the sentences together and yet there's no transformation or challenge that comes out of it. We're not reading necessarily the Bible for what it can do for us or how it can transform us, but we're reading it because we know we ought to. Anybody ever done that? It's kind of like, I tell you, it scares me sometimes. There are times when I drive here to home in Jackson, and I don't even remember I went through Humboldt. Like, I'm going to drive on the road, and all of a sudden it's like, I keep waiting for Humboldt to come up. Next thing I know, I'm coming up in Jackson. Now, good thing is I didn't run off the road or anybody else off the road. But the bad thing is I was kind of sightseeing. I was kind of focused elsewhere. One of the greatest things, one of the greatest portions I would take away from this is that the wise men, and the reason they were wise, is they came seeking. They came thirsty for knowledge, trying to find out. They had received an epiphany, a thought, an idea, something to go in search of, and they searched out and found Christ. And so, as I look at the Israelites and realize that they were just sightseers or bystanders, and I remember all the congregations that I've pastored, and I think, how often should I have implored? Let us not be bystanders or sightseers. Let us not just go through the motions. It's easy to do because a lot of the stuff we do is repetitive. And it happens time and time again. But let us take a moment. We're in a new year. Let us start off strong. Let us start off this year seeking God's will for us, seeking God's presence in our lives, seeking what God has for us in 2021. Not saying, "Ooh, I'm glad 2020's done," because I got to tell you, some of the same stuff we faced there, we're still going to face. And quite frankly, it's nothing new with the Spanish flu, with other influences and other things people have faced before. Crazy times come around again and again. It's a cycle. But so is seeking. If you do it properly, you seek, you receive the epiphany, you receive the revelation, and then you continue to search and try to discover new things, discover what God is doing, what God has you planned to do, what God has prepared you to do, not 10 years from now, but what has God set up for you to do this year? As long as we draw breath on this planet, as long as we can praise God in this house and transfer out, we have a mission that God has given to us. And my encouragement is that we, as a church and as individual believers, go into 2021 seeking what God has for us. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Father God, I give you thanks and praise for the gift of the Christ child, for the light which you shone into this world that dispels the darkness. Lord, as we move from one year to another, let us not worry about the darkness, let us not fear the darkness, but let us seek the light. Let us seek to reflect it in our actions, in our thoughts, in our words. Let us seek to serve you with all the blessings and the gifts that you have given to us. And let us do all these things to the glory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen and amen. I now invite you to join me in our communion liturgy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord. Let us pray. Eternal God, who has created the heavens and the earth, giving breath to every living thing, we thank you for all the gifts of creation and for the gift of life itself. We thank you for making us each in your own image, for forgiving us when we act as though you have no claim upon us, for keeping us in your steadfast care. We rejoice in Jesus Christ, the only eternally begotten by you, who was born of the Virgin Mary, who shared the joys and the sorrows of life as we know it. We remember Christ's death. We celebrate Christ's resurrection. And in the beloved community of your church, we await Christ's return at the end of history. We take courage from the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit in our midst, and we offer our praise for women and men of faith in every age who stand as witnesses to your love and justice. With all the prophets and the martyrs and the saints and all the company of heaven, we glorify you now singing. We remember on the night when he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Take, eat. Do this in remembrance of me." And then after supper, he took the cup. After giving thanks, he blessed it, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. Take, drink. Do this in remembrance of me." By the eating of this bread and the drinking of this cup, we proclaim Christ's death, we celebrate Christ's resurrection, and we wait Christ's coming again. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ shall come again. Amen. The body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for the forgiveness of sin. Let us pray. Holy and gracious Father, as we gather around this table that you have prepared for us, we receive the sacrifice which Christ made on our behalf. We receive the promise that he gave to us and the blessings that he offered. Let us, in doing so, through the power of your Spirit, be spiritually uplifted, be strengthened, and be blessed to overflowing, that as we go forth from this place, that we would show Christ in our daily living, that we would reach out to all those in need, that we would continue to be a reflection of your light in this world and dispel further darkness. We pray this in all things in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Now to stand and sing our closing hymn, "What Child Is This?" verses 1 and 3. Receive now the Lord's benediction. Brothers and sisters, we have gathered the house of the Lord to worship in spirit and in truth. We have heard his word proclaimed. We have come to his table and received the meal he has prepared for each of us. Therefore, through the power of the Holy Spirit, receive the peace of Christ, which passes all understanding. May he be and abide in you now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Go in peace to love and serve our Lord.